$10,000 or something just to,
oh.
to do that. So that's why,
oh.
You know, University of Illinois is going to have that, UIC is going to have that because they have more money.
Oh.
So that's, it's not that, I'm sure if they could afford it, they would do
oh.
it.
Oh, it is good to know that.
Yeah, it's not their
yeah.
fault.
Okay. Yeah, well, you know, as a user,
mm-hmm.
so never blame the user. Rule number one.
Okay.
As a user, I would like to, you know, have such library websites, like that library web services. So I just want to use the user experience. That's the topic that I'm looking for. And I'm just making a selection like bring the full text online. So it doesn't matter for me whichever database
right.
is reading. So I just want to read the most recent articles about on this topic. So that is my target. This is my goal. So do the same task with the, you know, your school library website or the NIU library. It is how we can do that. Most recent articles about user experience. Online journal articles. Can we do that at the NIU website?
Well, you have to go to the databases.
Yeah.
You have to know what databases
to
go
to.
Yeah.
I feel like their databases.
But
are
there are like sub-discipline sites
mm-hmm.
that will host
like
databases for those
like
disciplines.
Uh-huh. You can't just get to like EBSCO or.
You can
you know
get
I mean?
Into one of the, well, the way the best way to do that is you kind of backdoor it. So you like, let's say you go into the, let's say you're going
yeah,
into
like
the academic
research complete. Yeah.
And then you
yeah.
go up on, there's a little thing and then you can choose databases and it'll pop it and you just check all the ones you want. So like, I'll look at that and then I'll do ERIC and then I'll do library and information, whatever. And then I'll just sort of search
okay.
the three databases, I think. But you just, it is, there is a little thing on the
yeah.
top left-hand side
yeah.
where you can, it'll pull up a box.
Well,
but you're still only an EBSCO.
Yeah.
Yeah. That's great. Yeah. Well, just a quick note, if you're just interested in user experience or such materials, the ACM database is, you know, kind of a database that you're just...
What's it called?
ACM.
ACM.
Application for computer.
Yeah, yeah. So the ACM is the most user experience journal because they have. And on the other hand, to reach the most recent articles, you can just do the Google search, Google Scholar search, and then find the article. If it's not online, you know, the full text, then you just go to an NIU library website and target the particular journal, do the research. Well, okay, we have already started talking about the user experience. Any questions so far? Okay. Well, think about that, whichever system you are using, iOS or Android, and why? How many of you are using iOS? iPhone. Okay, how many of you are using Android, and why? Just because of the front, yeah.
I have to have an iPhone because I can't have nice things.
Okay.
So the warranties with the iPhones are much better.
Okay.
With my last one, I went through like 5 phones in the first year.
Uh-huh.
And every time I broke it, I just went into the Apple store and they gave me a new one.
Oh.
And so they're more expensive, but if you break that many phones, then it's cheaper in the long run to buy the more expensive one and buy the warranty.
Okay. Yeah, good. Yeah, what else?
I think iOS is the safety in iOS system
yeah.
is more than Android,
mm-hmm.
and I think a lot of time that be useful for user and a lot of people looking for security.
Okay.
That's
okay.
It.
For security, yes.
I found like with Android, usually they start to lag over time, and
okay.
it's now, everything in iOS is pretty fast.
Okay. Yeah, you know, you're just concerned about the efficiency. Okay, good. Yeah.
I had a blue Android phone,
mm-hmm.
and the thing that I don't like about that, apparently like Samsung is stock Android, but if you get one of those cheap phones, it's not. And so everything that everyone was like, how can you not? I'd be like, I don't know how to do this. And they'd be like, oh, do this, this, this. And then they'd look at my phone and be like, oh, it's different on your phone. I can't figure it out. So I couldn't do any, like, anything I couldn't figure out how to do.
Mm-hmm.
All of the, anything online was for, like, stock Android. And
mm-hmm.
I don't know what, blue, why they changed different things, but they weren't where it was elsewhere, and I find that too annoying to figure it out. So seems to be like consistent across the board now like that.
Okay, good, yeah.
Can I ask, it's a great user experience when you go to the store, if you go to the Apple store and you go to the expert counter, mm-hmm. you make an appointment, you can find anything, and you can also, I'm surprised at how much research like school I was able to do on the phone. I did a lot of my work for the phone.
Okay, that's a good point.
The Android, I don't think I would have been able to.
Okay, good. Right. So we have our own reasons to pick some particular system, right? The platform. So we're just talking as a user right now. So we are users. And since as a developer, you're not the only one that's offering that product. So we have like other competitors offering the same thing, right? So as a user, in the standpoint of the user, so we have our own reasons. So you need to create your, you know, benefits to the target users if you are the designer. So which email account are you using? Gmail? Are you using Gmail? How about Yahoo? And are you, for your personal? Okay. What are your reasons? Oh.
I've done that in the past, but I don't like, okay, so the last time I did that, I set up an alias so that it would reply in a certain way, and then I didn't touch any of my settings, and the alias started to fail. So this time, when I get, I'll have like a student NIU, and I think I'm just going to use like Outlook and have them be selected and select who I'm sending from.
Okay.
I don't know. I mean, I actually use Proton Mail, but.
Okay.
And then I forgot.
You forgot my encryption password.
Okay, good. Yeah, we are now never blaming users.
Except that's totally my fault.
So it's a part of the life that we need to forget the password, so it doesn't matter. Yeah, and do you stick with any particular email account because of just you're using for years?
Email.
Yeah. Yeah, right? You don't need to, you know, switch to a new account because you use it for years. So you are just, you know, loyal users of this kind of like email account. So the users tend to use longer times if they like it. Okay.
I think over half of people use Yahoo Mail.
Yeah. Yeah.
Oh, okay.
I feel like you have to use Gmail because it's like YouTube and it's got all of that stuff now.
Yes. Exactly.
And look
how
like my company does G Suite, like they use Google Drive and everything.
Yeah, many people are just using Gmail because they can do one email for multiple occasions. Yeah, we have our own reasons to stick with some particular products like cost efficiency and effectiveness, security, or ease of use, or just loyalty of using for years and years, you're very used to use, and it is much easier for you to, you know, manage all the products. So, well, think about the technology that we're using 7 years ago. What kind of cell phone were you using? Do you remember? In 2010.
Smile phones.
smile phones. And flip phones. Yeah. So right now, I think all of us are using smartphones, right?
Yes.
Yeah. And how about the technology that we're going to use within 7 years? Are you using smartwatches? Yeah. Yeah, we're using right now. And we are going to start using new technology. Here is a kind of like a user experience in a short video. Okay, this is the technology. Now we're having new technology each and every day. Okay.
Thank you.
that is the point, that users react against to the software. But this is the problem with the hardware, the computer, or the design. Right. So
Depends on what's going on.
The user at the table they use, and it gets angry and angry and angry, and then you know here's the reaction that just destroy everything. So if you are designing for someone which is kind of like software which is mandatory for some particular user groups, like as I said, it's a strategic improvement for teachers, and you're working as a teacher in the school, and one day you have been notified that okay, you have to use this tool to report the grades, and you start using it and find it very complex, and it creates your anger and you know creates stress for yourself, and then you probably will start blaming someone, putting this you know just in front of you. And you may want some help, right? You need to call someone, you need to ask your colleague how to do it, and it creates, you know, stress for yourself. So that is the attitude of the users. So yeah, again, if you're designing, just keep it simple and simple and simple. And what is UX? What is UX dealing with? In the user experience, we are dealing with the user's emotions. So we are all people or human beings, and we are just carrying out our feelings while we are using the products. We love our phones, we dislike our phones, or we love our laptop computers and the software that we are using, or we hate them. So we are just carrying out our emotions. In the user experience, we are trying to understand people's emotions. We call it as users in this course. We are just dealing with the users' emotions, their attitudes, and their expectations from the product. And for example, the sample that we are using the NIU website, my expectation is like typing the one word and doing all the material for me. So this is my expectation. But you know, there is a problem over there. It's not matching exactly. So okay, here I have like some questions, some concerns about the library website. So, you may say that, okay, technically it is not possible, something like that. But the users are never dealing with the technology just behind the sign, or technology, how much does it cost to the university or something. So, as a user, you're just asking, this is my expectation, so I want to see this one. And, I was working with the government agencies, and especially for the the high level agencies are very use of lack of technology or having some problems using technology. They always say a sentence at the very first 5 minutes, like say, "I want to hit one click and I want to see this report." And there's nothing like that. You have to hit at least like three clicks or something. But they are just expressing their expectations that I don't want to, spend a lot of time, or I don't want to increase my cognitive workload. I want to hit enter button and it goes to printer and I want to see the report. So those are the things that the expectations of the users are really matters to us. And if possible, we need to carry out all these expectation design process. So if possible, definitely we should do it. But in development cycle, if you're just working with the developers, software engineers, if you just raise a concern, probably the answer that you can hear is, oh, we are using PHP for coding, it is not possible with the PHP, we should use JavaScript or something. So that's not the answer for the users. Users are never dealing with whether you are using JavaScript or PHP or HTML or something. They just want to see, they just ask, they just want to have this functionality in this system. So in user experience, we are going to understand the user's expectations, okay? And their perceptions, their mental model, how they are seeing the world, how they are you know, interacting with the system. For example, I can say, okay, here's the NIU website. My perception, okay, I'm gonna see the one top best university in the nation. And I can see like such information on the website. And when I go back, if the information is missing, I can say that, or I can start thinking that, okay, I think this is not the top university in the nation. Because with my perception, my expectation is really high. Yeah.
I mean, okay, so UX research, UX design, and then like visual design.
Mm-hmm.
If you have the same, like you find in UX, if you have the exact same app or website or whatever with the buttons in the same place,
mm-hmm.
but one looks fairly plain,
mm-hmm.
and the other one is really visually beautiful.
Yeah.
What, I mean, so assuming the UX is the same, is there a place for a visual, and then what's the balance? Because I'm doubting it's ever going to be exactly equal like that. So what's the balance of, because I mean, statistically, right, you put up, you know, you see statistics on my website, right? People much prefer interacting with something that looks beautiful than
mm-hmm.
something that's just blah.
Yeah.
So how does that?
Yeah. Well, the answer is totally depends on your target audience.
Okay.
So if you're just designing for senior citizens, go ahead and ask that. Which one looks better for them? So you'll get the answer. So there is no a clear answer for any condition. So your target audience matters. Okay. For example, if you're designing for the young people, probably you should use social media icons for them, because they're pretty much interacting with the social media. They can easily capture what you mean. Right? If you see an envelope, it means email for them, so something like that. Okay, but if you just show the same icon to the senior student, they can just interact in a totally different way. So your target audience is really important. And in order to get the answer in UX, you should conduct a research with your target audience. You should pick some group of people from your target audience and then bring it into the laboratory, or you can just visit them at their place, their offices, their homes, and show the screen and see them interacting with the software. And think about station, they just providing verbal comments, and they can just express their thoughts. Like, I like this button, but I don't like it. What does this mean? Something like that. So for example, as a user, just in order to drop off the course, you're just looking for a kind of like a button, like
drop.
Where is the drop button? And you can just find. And as a user, for example, if I design the website, and as a user, you can just say that I want to drop the course, but I couldn't find a particular button or a link for dropping off the course. I can say that, okay, it is hidden under the enroll button, so I need to change enroll/drop. Maybe it could help. Or just separate the two buttons, enroll and drop. And if a student already enrolled in the class, just put in the gray area to the enroll button, it means that you have already enrolled it and activated the drop button right now. So you can understand, I have already enrolled it and I need to drop it. So those are kind of like, understand what I mean? So it is totally depend on your target audience, their expectations, and their mental model. So as a user, you can say that, okay, I need a drop button in here. So it is okay, yes, you are, you need. So that is the thing that you are going to get the answer by testing it with the actual users.
So the main takeaway I already have from this class is anyone who designs anything without somebody knowledgeable about UX during the process is probably doing it wrong.
Yes. Yeah, well, actually, I was working with the software engineers for like more than 10 years, and they are technical guys. They always see technically. So they just tell me that, okay, it's functional, and it's over there. They can drop the class by hitting the enroll button. It's over there. The database is working. They can drop online. So that is the perspective of the technical people, the functionality, and it works fine. Yeah, they can submit the information to the database. They can acquire the information from the database. So it's working. So, but as a UX researcher and designer, we are advocating the users' rights, okay? We are the advocates of the users. And we are going to ask users whatever they want, what they're willing to see, what kind of problems they're encountering, and then they're coming back to the developers and telling them that, okay, you should correct this layer or change this design into such, right? Or add this one, delete this one. It is confusing, just make it clear or something. Okay, and with the suggestion. Because in user experience, we're not just expressing the complaints of the users. At the same time, sometimes users offer really great ideas. Like, place an item right in here, and it could be very helpful. Oh, we never thought about that. Yes, it could be helpful. So those are the things we need to care. And in UX research methods, we're going to advocate the users. Okay? And we are going to understand the product's value, like how much it creates benefits to the target audience, at what level they are satisfied with the use with the product. So we're going to measure and calculate this one. We don't need to analyze this. And what is not UX? We are not testing user skills in this box. So again, number one rule is never blame the user. We are not going to test the skills of the users. We are not going to blame. There are no wise users. They couldn't use it. Because this is a technology for all. We are, if you are developing something, we are designing and developing for this type of user groups. And if the users among these groups, so he has a right to say anything to you. Okay? So we're not going to measure their skills. The user experience, there is nothing like that. Okay, here is the right design, here is the worst design, this is the best one. No, there's nothing like that. So it is a very dynamic environment. Because everything is changing. The needs are changing, the users are changing, technology is changing. And each and every day, somebody just offering a new product, a new software that we can just uninstall one and install the other one, start using it from now on. So it is a changing environment, and we need to keep an eye on the users, how they are interacting with the technology and the tools. And we are trying to understand how the product and the user experience and the user expectations may be. What are the gaps? What are the problems? For example, the users' expectations from the NIU library website on this level, but the library website is providing service on this level. Okay, here there is a gap. So we are, as the UX researcher, we are trying to identify all these problems and gaps. And then we can be an advocate of the user and go ahead and present and say that, okay, here's the problem with the library website. We should have something like that. And probably the next question will be, and how much budget do you need? And then we can say, okay, here's the $10,000 per month. Okay, forget it.
It's so expensive. First of all, you have to input all of, you can pay more upfront because you have to input all of your data and get it so that it goes in there. So you've got, so there's an initial startup cost. But you're also paying for that service. So I think, and I haven't looked at the bills, I don't pay the bills, but I think it's the initial thing that's like $10,000, but it's probably about $8,000 a year to sustain it, on top of all the purchases of the databases.
Well,
so it is expensive.
Yeah, well, on the other hand, we can just, we may have an answer, something like that. Okay, if it is important for our, you know, research community, for students, definitely we can just provide that money, buy it. But, you know, just we're just increasing the awareness that, okay, here there are, you know, some gaps between user expectations and the current services. We need to fill this gap out, and so our students can be more productive, we can just publish more, we can gain more benefits. But you're just identifying the problems with the solutions, perfect, for the administrators. And we are going to measure the performance and the satisfaction of the software. Again, we're not testing the skills of the users, but we're testing the tools and the products, and how people are interacting with, and how much benefit the product provides for the users.